Doctor Who. The Massacre by John Lucarotti. Read by Peter Purves. Prologue. The Doctor sat in the garden, which always reminded him of the Garden of Peace, when Stephen, no, not Stephen, his granddaughter Susan, and that nice young couple Barbara and Ian had their adventure with the Aztec Indians eons ago. But his reminiscences were elsewhere, as he browsed through a copy of Samuel Pepys's famous diary of a Londoner's life in the second half of the 17th century. He chuckled at the succinct observation and laid the open book down beside him on the bench. He looked around contentedly. His journeys through time and space in the TARDIS had come to a temporary halt. His differences, as he chose to refer to them with the Time Lords, of which, after all, he was one, were more or less resolved. This celestial retirement was a far from unpleasant condition when one's memories were so rich. He had had more than his fair share of adventure, and secretly he believed that his fellow lords were a mite jealous of his achievements.
"As well they might be," he murmured to a passing butterfly.
That was the moment when he heard their voices all around him. "Doctor," they intoned in unison. He looked up at the blue sky.
"Yes, gentlemen?"
"There is a certain matter we would," they continued, but the Doctor cut across them.
"Just one spokesman, if you don't mind," he said testily. "I'm not deaf."
"The subject concerns your activities," one of them began.
"Ah," the Doctor interjected.
"On the planet Earth in the 16th century," the voice continued. "The year 1572, Earth time, to be precise."
"My memory's not quite what it was, gentlemen," the Doctor replied, remembering in full his involvement in the momentous events of that year. "Perhaps a further indication would help me to recall exactly where the TARDIS landed?"
"Paris, France," the Time Lord said.
"Paris, France," the Doctor repeated slowly as if he were concentrating. "Yes, I do seem to remember some kind of technical malfunction in the TARDIS which deposited me there, but only briefly. I think an hour or so in their time, was it not?"
"Several days, Doctor."
"Really? As long as that?"
The Doctor did his best to sound surprised. "We shall accord you a period of time for reflection, Doctor," the spokesman continued. "But be warned, our research into the affair reveals that your conduct was highly suspect."
"Indeed,"
the Doctor replied, and wondered how best to extricate himself from yet another difference. Chapter 1. The Roman Bridge Auberge. The TARDIS landed with a jolt, which almost threw the young astronaut Stephen Taylor off balance. But the Doctor did not seem to notice as he studied the parameters of the time-place-orientation printout on the central control panel of the time machine.
"Earth again," he observed, and waited for the digits of the time print to stop as they clicked by.
But they didn't, at least not the last two. The first settled at 1 and the second at 5, but the last two fluctuated between 0 and 9 indiscriminately.
"In the 1500s. We'll know exactly when in a moment," he added hopefully,
but it was not to be. The numbers kept flickering by on the screen. "No one should allow a kid like me to go up in a crate like this," Stephen joked, but his humour was lost on the Doctor.
"Perhaps we should ask Mission Control for permission to return for an overhaul?" "I am Mission Control," the Doctor replied sourly,
and ordered Stephen to open the door as he switched off the main power drives, leaving the interior lighting on the auxiliaries. Stephen obeyed. And the stench of putrefaction which hit him in the face almost made him ill on the spot. Under a fierce sun in the clear blue sky, the TARDIS stood in the middle of mounds of decomposing rubbish. There was also a wooden fence a little higher than the TARDIS, which entirely surrounded them and had a door in it. "Ah, perfect," the doctor observed as he looked out. He wore his cloak over his clothes, and his Astrakhan hat was on his head. In one hand he held his silver-topped cane, in the other a handkerchief to his nose. "Heh, putrescence, just what we need," he added as someone on the other side of the fence threw several rotting cabbages over it. "Heh, couldn't be better."
"Your logic escapes me, Doctor," Stephen replied.
"My dear boy," the doctor said indulgently, "people throw their rubbish over the fence rather than bring it in, which means that the TARDIS will remain unobserved here whilst we," he gestured airily, "explore."
"What's to explore?"
"The other side of the fence, since the aromas on this side of it give me a clue as to where we might be."
The doctor momentarily lifted a corner of the handkerchief.
"Garlic! Definitely garlic," he said,
and then told Stephen to fetch a cloak to wear so that they could begin their exploration. With the TARDIS locked behind them, the doctor picked his way delicately through the refuse towards the door.
"We'll need to use the EDF system when we return," he said, just before they reached it.
"What's that?" Stephen asked.
"The external decontamination function," the doctor replied.
"Oh, a sort of spatial car wash," Stephen joked. The doctor glared at him, opened the door cautiously, and peered out.
The fence was on a square of land on one side of the unpaved, pitted street, rutted by carriage wheels. The refuse that had not been thrown over the fence lay there and was being picked at by emaciated dogs. The buildings on both sides were mostly adjoining, between one and two stories high, with overhanging eaves and slated or thatched roofs. The walls were braced with wooden beams, and from most of the small open windows with slatted shutters came pungent odours of cooking. The people on the street, and they were many, stood or walked under the eaves or in the middle of it. There were hawkers pushing carts laden with meats, vegetables, fish, and crustaceous seafoods of every kind. There was a knife sharpener with his grinding wheel, a carpenter with his mobile lathe, and the remainder of his tools in a leather haversack on his back. There were also vendors with their trays slung by straps from their necks, filled with every variety of cheaply made knick-knack. And all of them were selling their wares simultaneously at the top of their voices. They wore breeches, billowing shirts, and clogs. Most of them had shoulder-length hair, frequently gathered in a bow at the back. Several had gaudy, gypsy-like bandanas on their heads, and a few wore curled, wide-brimmed flat hats. The women to whom they sold their goods wore full-flowing skirts and blouses, and their hair was mostly tied back with ribbons. Both buyer and seller negotiated with shouts and yells, shoulder shrugs, arms akimbo, the language of hands and the turning of backs, but each side knowing that shortly the bargain would be struck. The doctor stood in the middle of the street, sniffed, and announced,
"France!"
Stephen smiled. "French is what they're speaking, doctor," he said.
"But when and where?" 1500 and something, the doctor replied, as Stephen wandered over towards the side of the street, trying to read a sign in the ground floor window. "Yeah, don't go there," the doctor shouted. "Under the eaves or in the middle, but not there, Stephen. It's dangerous."
"Why?" Stephen asked. And a moment later, an arm appeared from the first floor window of the house next door and emptied a chamber pot. "Vive la France," Stephen muttered as he retreated hastily to the doctor's side.
"Oh, look at that," the doctor exclaimed, pointing to a shuttered shop. "It's an apothecary's, and it's closed." Has been for some time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.